We are going now from old Calcutta out to the state of Assam. This is the state that borders up on Burma and China in the far east of India. And it's the very undeveloped area that still has quite a bit of natural wildlife.
Now, among the problems that you might find in Assam, there is an elephant problem. Farmers are trying to grow crops in areas that elephants remember as their own. And while the elephants don't object to the farmers growing the crops, come harvest time, there is a dispute about who owns them. I remember a story about a photographer who went into Assam to document the trouble that there were with the farmers. And so one night, when the elephants were raiding the crops, he went out with the farmers who were trying to defend them. The result of that was a battle because the elephants didn't want to go easily, and there were a certain amount of fireworks and so forth involved. And the natives had had some torches with them, some kerosene torches, and they were out there trying to chase the elephants away. The elephants eventually had enough of it, and they charged the natives, at least some of them did. And in that charge, the natives basically broke and ran. And when they did, one of the bull elephants discovered the photographer and ran towards him. The photographer, of course, ran in the other direction, which is the only rational thing that you can do in a circumstance quite like this. It was night, however, and he couldn't see exactly where he was going, and in any event, you really can't outrun an elephant. He tripped, and he fell into a ditch. Now, the elephant would, under normal circumstances, have no difficulty finding him and thrashing him in one of several different ways. Crushing them with the elephant's head is one of the elephant's favorite ways to dispatch problems. But the elephant could not sniff the person out, and the reason was because of those kerosene torches that I told you about. They had left a very acrid kerosene smell in the air, and the elephant simply could not make out where the photographer had disappeared to. And so the result is he was able to tell his story later, and he even had his equipment intact. Nevertheless, like they say, elephants never forget. And a fairly large number of elephants in Assam don't forget that they're not particularly fond of people. I remember another story where some natives were minding their own business walking down a dirt road. And this was during the day, and they weren't paying much attention to what was going on around them. And an elephant slipped out of the forest and came up behind them and trashed them. So the elephants, the wild elephants in particular in Assam, are not necessarily to be trusted. Chances are they've got a grudge against people.
This is a tea plantation in Assam, and originally the British discovered that the Chinese had a monopoly on the tea business, and the British decided that they would break it. So they got tea plants smuggled out of China, and they found a location in India where the tea plants would grow nicely, and that was in Assam along the Brahmaputra River, which is where most of the tea plantations are today. So this was the British attempt to break that Chinese monopoly. the tea plantations are essentially still worked the same way that they were under the British Empire. We're going up to Kesaranga National Park, and that borders on the Brahmaputra River, and we're going to be doing at least some of our sightseeing by elephant back. That's something that doesn't disturb the other animals when you do that, and in addition, other animals generally don't attack you while you're on the back of an elephant.
And now we're off for the down patrol.
Patrol again.
Company! Shut up!
Oh, the aim of our patrol is a question rather droll. For to march and drill over field and hill
is a military goal.
Is a military goal. Hut, two, three, four, press it up. Two, three, four.
Something that's easy to see from the back of an elephant is the one-horned Indian rhino. The Indian rhino is roughly the same size as the African rhino. It's a little smaller. But it's extraordinarily rare, except up here in Assam. Something else that's a little bit different with the Indian rhino is that if you take a look at the skin flaps, they look much more like they are iron plates that have been bolted onto the animal. It looks much more like an armored vehicle than the African rhino does. All rhinos have the habit of having community toilets. That is, the toilets for all of the rhinoceros in the local area tend to be in one location. And so there's one very, very large pile of rhino poo. This rhino poo is apparently very good for the soil because stuff likes to grow out of it almost immediately. If you're not on the back of an elephant, you might be in a safari vehicle. And in this next scene on the safari vehicle, there is a guard, and this guard has a .303 rifle that is so old, possibly dating back as far as World War I. That the guard has no ammunition that he's put into it. He hasn't put any ammunition into it because he's afraid that if he fires it, the gun will explode. I had first thought that these two elephants were perhaps a mother and her child. And I watched for a little while and I realized that that couldn't possibly be the case, and you'll see why a little bit later. You see, among Indian elephants, only the male has tusks. In African elephants, both sexes have tusks, but that's not true with the Indian elephant. And while you probably notice that the younger one has tusks, the older one does as well, and you'll see that a little bit later on. So this is actually two males that are playing in the water, and one is much bigger than the other. And so I'm concluding from that that it's entirely possible that we're dealing with a couple of brothers here. Please notice the vegetation near the elephants. That floating vegetation is water hyacinth. That's common in the United States, but it is actually indigenous to South America. Apparently, water hyacinth, which is a weed almost every place, including South America, has now spread very much worldwide. Although these elephants look entirely friendly and playful, not all elephants are always treating people that way. Now, that's especially true if you've got a mother and her child. The mother could be very defensive. And there is something that elephants often do. It's called a mock charge. It's a half charge, a charge that's going to stop short of actually making contact. However, occasionally elephants will make an actual charge. Now, how do you tell the difference between a mock charge and an actual charge? Well, look at this elephant, and you can see that her trunk is up underneath her jaw. It's being protected. When elephants make an actual charge, they do protect their trunks. If the elephant's trunk is left dangling, it's a mock charge, and this one changes into a mock charge. Incidentally, this video was shot at Kasserenga. These next are deer. There's all kinds of different kinds of deer at Kasserenga. These happen to be still in velvet. The difference between antlers and horns is that horns are permanent. Antlers fall off every year and have to be regrown. And as they're being regrown, they have skin over them, and that's referred to as being in velvet. The great thing about riding an elephant is that you can refuel your vehicle almost anywhere, anytime, while you're observing the wildlife. Right now, these old boys are acting a lot more like hippopotamus than like rhinoceros. India doesn't have hippopotamus, so it's clear that these can't possibly be hippos, no matter how far away they are when you take a look at them, even though they're half submerged in the water. Did you ever look closely at the leg of an elephant and how it's built? If you do, the part of the leg that is analogous to the human elbow, that points back. It bends back towards the rear of the animal. The little part that seems to bend forward, that's the wrist down there near the foot or the ankle, depending on how you want to look at it. And the animal itself is actually walking on its tiptoes. And the reason that the foot looks flat is because there's a ball of cartilage under the heel. These buffalo don't look dangerous, but they are. They can be quite aggressive. They're not nearly as aggressive as the Cape buffalo in South Africa, but that doesn't mean they're safe to be around either. These buffalo look like they're a little bit nervous, and while they're in low grass, there's good reason for them to feel safe. But in that high grass that's nearby, there could be tigers lurking, and the buffalo may very well be concerned about that. Well, clearly, something has them spooked. They almost certainly smell something. This is a monitor lizard. It's a scaled-down version of a Komodo dragon. And this varanid, like all of them, has venom glands. Those venom glands were just recently discovered, initially with the Komodo dragon, and now they believe all monitor lizards have those same glands. Monitor lizards are primarily predators of eggs, especially crocodile eggs. In fact, they're called monitor lizards because they monitor crocodiles. Now here's something that the monitor would clearly have an interest in. Now this may look to you like a chicken, but it's actually a jungle fowl. It's the ancestor of modern chickens. Now that we've covered cows and chickens, we might as well cover pigs. This is a sow. And she's going to be followed by three of her offspring. Together, the sow and the offspring are referred to as a sounder. Now the important thing here is that this is not a monkey. Now you can tell it's not a monkey for at least two reasons. First of all, there's no tail. Now, all apes have no tail, but monkeys generally have tails. There are a few monkeys that don't. More importantly, if you look at the way that it swings through the trees, you'll see that it has a rotating shoulder. And the result of that is, this must be an ape. The black ones, incidentally, are male, and the brown one was female. These are gibbons. Incidentally, the noise in the background are cicadas, as you would expect. This, on the other hand, is in fact a monkey. It's a langur. And one of the ways that you can tell that it's a monkey is because it does have a tail. This tail droops down out of the trees. It is not prehensile. Only American monkeys have tails that are prehensile and can grab hold of things.